you know, it's been a long, good ride. I think, you know, this last year obviously was kind of the peak for me, and looking at LA, they're, you know, obviously kind of rebuilding, and they got a young group down there, young core, and I think, you know, now it's kind of just the right time to step in there, and hopefully I can take advantage of the opportunity down there, and just kind of felt it was the right time.
What enabled you to grow your career the way you did here in Hockey Valley? What allowed you to become the player that you are today?
I just say that my teammates, the people around me, you know, starting with my freshman year, we had, you know, great leaders, great upperclassmen, and, you know, they brought me in right away, you know, it's a family there, and just, you know, working with all those guys, you know, it was never a down day. It was always fun coming to the rink. So usually when it's fun to come to the rink, you're always getting better and you're pushing each other, and I think that's kind of what's kind of molded me into the player I am now.
You mentioned that this season was a peak for you. I mean, you start with a hat trick the opening night of the season. Did you have a feeling from then on that it was going to be a really good year?
Maybe. I mean, for me, it's kind of the goal scoring's kind of came and gone, right? You know, obviously having that hot start was big, you know, kind of build my confidence right off the bat. And obviously I knew I was doing something right and kind of just wanted to stick with what I was doing because it was working. And but yeah, it was great to start off like that.
You mentioned before that with team success comes individual success, and you, along with Nate Soucy's, the program's first two All-Americans. Does that mean something to you, though, to be one of the first to accomplish such a special feat as a Nittany Lion?
Yeah, I mean, you could just look through the past few years. Like, you know, it could be anybody who, you know, would get that accolade. And, you know, it's definitely cool to be the first to do it. But, you know, there's people before me that, you know, that were up there that, you know, maybe should have gotten that accolade before me. But, no, it's cool. It's cool that, you know, we're starting to get recognized out there in Happy Valley, and hopefully, you know, that continues.
Who should play with Paul DeNaples next year? You guys had such great chemistry. Oh, where does he go from here?
Oh, man, I'll have to ask him what he's thinking. I don't want to give my thoughts. That's the coach's decision. But I know they got a couple of young D-men coming in that look ready to step in right away, and obviously, you know, we got, you know, the guys there right now. So, I mean, you know, playing with Paul, I think anybody's going to enjoy playing with him. Obviously, you know, me and him, you know, we mold so well together. He's easy to play with. So I think whoever he plays with, he's going to find success.
How are you spending your time socially distanced?
A lot of gaming. So it's a nice way to stay intact with the group. So we got a bunch of gamers on the team. So we'll, you know, we'll play, you know, almost every night and just kind of connect. And, you know, it's good to stay connected with those guys. I've been working out a little bit, but other than that, just trying to eat well and get my body right and do what I can during this time.
Are you a part of the Madden group or the Call of Duty group?
Call of Duty. The Madden group, they're not real gamers. You know, the real guys are on the Call of Duty. So I think everybody would agree with that.
Well, Cole, congratulations. We look forward to watching you continue your career at the NHL level, and we'll miss seeing you here in Hockey Valley.
Yeah, thanks, Tripp. We're going to miss it too.
Big thanks to Cole Hultz and Penn State for letting us use that interview. Baylor, you excited about Cole Hultz? I mean, everybody keeps talking about what an incredible prospect pool the Kings have, and it seems like every day you turn around, there's a new player, a new prospect that's getting some attention. That's the future. Let's talk about the present. Birthdays this week. Former Kings defenseman and Stanley Cup champion Robin Regier celebrated a birthday on April 19th. Current LA Kings defenseman Ben Hutton celebrated his birthday on April 20th. Former Kings forward and current broadcaster with Fox Sports West, Derek Armstrong, celebrated his birthday, as well as former defenseman and Stanley Cup champion Willie Mitchell, both on the 23rd, that's today. And, of course, former Kings forward Tyler Toffoli celebrated his birthday on April 24th. Kings fans, we know that if there were live games, you'd have a chance to get your birthdays, your anniversaries, your life cycle events shown up on the Jumbotron. If you want to have them be a part of the show, don't hesitate. Reach out to me or Bailey on social media. Get us that info, and we will see about getting your name in the show here at All the Kings Men Live. But now, Michael Amadio and Austin Wagner joined me earlier for a conversation. Here it is. LA Kings forwards, Michael Amadio and Austin Wagner. Fellas, how you doing?
Doing good.
Yeah.
Again in quarantine.
Yeah, just hanging in there.
Now, I'm going to pretend that I'm not an old man here, and I'm going to ask you, Austin, if I'm playing Fortnite every night, am I cool or am I
She's a little kid pretending to be a gamer.
Not a lot of us play Fortnite anymore.
All right.
I don't know. I think there's not much to do, so might as well get on the sticks.
What do you say, Michael?
Yeah, I think a lot of guys switched over to Warzone during this time, but definitely a lot of video games are being played, so no judgment here.
I appreciate it. Now, both of you have nicknames, at least as far as the fans know, that sort of defy the nickname convention. Michael, as I understand it, you go by Mods, and Austin, as far as I know, you go by Wags. Usually, hockey nicknames end with either the E sound or the R sound, whether it's Kopi or, you know, Dewey or Greener or something like that. How long have you had those nicknames? We'll start with you, Michael.
I've had my nickname for a while. Some guys call me Ammo too, so it's a little bit of a mix of both. More of the Canadian guys, I think, would call me Ammo, and the American guys call me Mad, so I get a little mix of both at the rink.
Ammo's a great, that's a great hockey name. You got to lean on him to switch it up. What about you, Austin? How long has Wags been your handle?
I think I've had Wags since I was probably a kid, honestly. Since I went into LA, I kind of got the nickname Swaggy too, so that's kind of one that's trailing behind me now, which I'm a huge fan of. But no, I've had Wags forever. Even my mom calls me that half the time. So,
well, I know I don't get a vote, but I'm a huge fan of Ammo and Swag. I think,
yeah.
I think those are great. Well, let's start with the numbers, Michael. Number 10. Is there any story behind number 10?
There's not. No, I wore 19 growing up, 9 or 19, and then I wore 18 in junior because 19 was taken. So I kind of just, 10 looks similar to both those numbers, so that's why I went with it.
And Austin, I'm assuming 51 was assigned to you. Usually higher numbers like that wind up being handed out to players when they join the team.
Yeah. Growing up, I wore 10. And then in junior, I wore 27. And those two didn't get the chance for those. So 51 was my number that I got in camp. And then I just kind of kept it. I didn't really care about it. Didn't care enough to change it. So
have you ever decided you wanted number 10 back? And you guys had to play Call of Duty for it. Who would win?
I don't know.
I think Wags might have me on this one.
If we had to go play any other game, though, I think Mods would have me.
Is that right?
Yeah.
I think so, yeah.
Mods would kill me.
Actually, I don't know. NBA, FIFA, you'd probably take.
Oh, dude, I'm so bad at FIFA. I have one win in games now.
Yeah, I'm not good at either.
Yeah, no.
Do you prefer to play by yourself or with other people when it comes, let's say, sports games? Do you prefer to play one-on-one or two-on-two, three-on-three?
I think maybe NHL, hopping on EASHL or whatever it's called.
Yeah.
I think maybe hop on with a couple buddies on that, but maybe other sports games, just play by yourself.
Yeah, like kind of like 2K, kind of just jump in the neighborhood with the guys. It's kind of fun, but yeah, I don't really play NHL, but yeah, like Mod said, if you get in the EASHL or whatever it's called, and then you play with your friends, it's pretty fun, but yeah, I haven't been on that in a while, so.
Let's talk about on real ice, not virtual ice. Austin, everybody knows you've got the speed, the blazing speed. Have you ever timed yourself against the times that get put up in the skills competition at the All-Star Games?
No, I have not actually. Maybe one day, but right now, nowhere open to even do that. So, kill some time. But no, I have no idea what I'd match up to a guy like McDavid. I think I'd get pretty smoked in the corners. My crossovers aren't that great. So,
What do you think, Michael? Would he have a shot at him?
I think he'd be pretty close. Yeah, he's. It's incredible to see how fast he is firsthand.
I mean, as a layman, right, as just a typical fan, Austin, you look faster than McDavid to me. Maybe, like you said, maybe in the corners. But that flat-out breakaway open ice speed is, it's impressive. Do you guys just stand back and marvel at it, Mike?
Sometimes, yeah. I mean, just the way he can take a D-man wide out of nowhere is it's crazy, yeah.
I think most of the time Mods is playing for the rebound because he knows it's not going in.
I just follow up behind.
Yeah, he follows up because he knows that there's going to be something there.
Now, we saw somebody giving you a hard time for it, Austin, on a drawn with Drew. What is it like? How long does it take to film one of those drawn with Drew segments, and how much stuff gets said that we don't see on the Jumbotron?
That was pretty raw, honestly. Everybody kind of goes back and forth with me about the breakaway thing, so it's kind of it's funny. I'm trying to work on it, but you know, it takes time. But the drawing of Drew is always fun. You know, it's actually quite hilarious if you're just sitting in it watching, because real time it makes it a lot more funny. So yeah, those segments are pretty good with Dewey. He's a character, that's for sure.
Everybody knows Drew as, you know, he gets listed as the best and the worst chirper on all those NHLPA polls. But I'm curious, Michael, who's the biggest, I don't want to say bully on the team, but who's the most talkative guy that maybe the fans don't know about on the team?
Ooh, I don't know. Maybe Wags. Talk a lot around the room. Not necessarily chirps, but he's always talking about something, always got something to say, something on his mind that he wants to talk about or anything. Yeah, I'd have to go with Wags.
Conversation guy, you know? He's trying to start conversation.
And who's the quietest in the room, Wagner?
Mods is pretty quiet.
Yeah.
I would say at one point when Klager was up, he was pretty quiet. But like, if you're going straight off the team, Juice is quiet. He's kind of like whistling or just like saying stuff that nobody knows what he's saying. But like, he doesn't.
Just making noises.
Yeah, he's like making a turkey call or something coming through the room, but you never hear this
talk. I'm gonna get to that in a second, but let's back up to Adrian Kempe. If he's so quiet, how did he get the nickname Juice, Michael? I think you might have been around long enough to know the story of that one.
I think Stutz started that in the American League, but he already had the nickname before I got it there. I think it was because how fast he was too. Like he had the juice. I don't know.
Yeah, I think that's what it was. I think.
Oh, I always thought it was because he was. I thought it was because he had like, you know, he was cocky or had attitude. I don't know. I guess I don't know. All right. So let's get back to the turkey calls and whistling. Whistling songs or just like random noises?
Just noises to get your attention, and then he just acts like he doesn't have attention.
Just random noises.
He just doesn't get in your head, honestly.
Fair enough. Yeah. Look, the stereotype is that goalies are, you know, crazy or they're a little bit off and everything. And then we talk to Cal Peterson. We hear from everybody that he's this normal, you know, right down the middle, just not crazy goalie. And then he tells a story about how he eats cereal, that he puts the milk in the bowl first, then the cereal, then he drinks the milk with a straw, and then he eats the cereal. Have either of you guys ever witnessed this?
I've seen him eat a bowl of cereal and never that way. So
okay.
I was pretty surprised to hear that.
Yeah, I haven't seen that, but no, Cal's pretty normal.
Yeah, he's not. He doesn't do turkey calls or talk to his pipes or anything like that.
No, he's not. He's not like
no,
that.
Yeah, I haven't seen any of that from him. Yeah.
All right, perfect. Well,
I've heard any of that from
Michael. Let's start with you. What are you doing to keep yourself busy these days? Are you investing in any video game franchises? Are you watching anything on Netflix?
Yeah, just a lot of video games we played. I mean, working out a little bit. I don't really have much at home, but Netflix. I haven't really started any new shows. I mean, I just finished Ozark, rewatching The Office again, obviously, and playing board games with the family. That's pretty much it.
Austin, how about you?
Yeah, kind of the same thing, just hanging out with the family. Fishing season's kind of starting to get up and going here with the weather being nice, so fly fishing's kind of starting to make its way into my life again, so doing that, and then video games, Netflix. I'm watching Trailer Park Boys all over again, so kind of getting some laughs and not the most intellectual show, but
it kills some time. That's for yeah, sure. You've got a lot of time on your hands. You don't have to worry about everything being the best. But I'm curious, Michael, when you go back and rewatch a show like The Office, do you start from the beginning and go in order, or are you just going for, you know, scrolling through the seasons and whatever episode jumps out at you?
I kind of just, I start from the beginning, but I'll sometimes skip an episode if I don't really want to watch it. Like, it's not that funny to me. So I kind of pick and choose the good episodes that I know that are going to make me laugh again.
And Austin, you mentioned fly fishing. I've never been fly fishing, but I imagine it's probably, I imagine social distancing isn't a huge issue when it comes to something like that.
No, definitely not. Right now there's a lot of people out, but the river is pretty big, so you can find a spot where there's nobody near you. So it's definitely social distancing, that's for sure.
If you couldn't be a professional hockey player, would you attempt a career at professional fishing?
No, I actually have a buddy out of Saskatchewan that's doing that. But
really?
Yeah, he has a huge fishing channel on Instagram. But no, I don't think I could do that for a career. I think I'd have to figure something else out.
Is he more famous in your hometown than you are for his career at fishing?
In Saskatchewan, yeah, he's pretty big. Saskatchewan's kind of all fishing though, so fishing and hunting out there. But Calgary's also a big city, so nobody really knows who I am, which is nice.
I mean, I'm sure somebody knows. You're in the NHL.
Somebody does, but you know, I try to keep a pretty low profile in the city.
All right, we'll let you guys go after this one question. Michael, of all the jerseys you've worn at any level, all the way down to, you know, your first team, what's your favorite jersey you've ever worn?
I think our gray alternate Kings jerseys are my favorite. I don't know why, I just love them. My second might have to be my junior jersey. The battalion green kind of grew on me after 4 years of wearing it, just because it was pretty unique and no one else really has that color. So I'd have to go with those two.
Thumbs up or thumbs down on the silver helmets from the Stadium Series game this year? Nice. And Austin, how about you? Favorite jersey?
The Chevy logo one was pretty cool, I thought, this year. The retros, those were pretty nice. I was excited to wear those again, but circumstances didn't let us. But another one might have been in junior, we had these St. Patrick's Day jerseys for the Pats, and they just said St. Pats. Are pretty sick, too. So we had a lot of jerseys like that, but yeah, no, those are cool.
And a thumbs up or thumbs down on the white gloves from those Stadium Series outfits. Nice. All right. Well, thank you, boys, very much for joining us. We appreciate it.
Yeah, no worries.
Yeah, thanks for having us.
Stay sane. Stay healthy.
Yeah, you too.
Talk to you soon.
Yeah, you as well.
Thanks again to Michael Amadio and Austin Wagner. And thanks to all of you watching on Twitch, on Facebook, on YouTube, on Twitter. Yeah, thanks to Matt Molson. That's right. Bailey says, thanks, Matt, for watching. We appreciate it. And a huge thank you to everybody at the Kings who labored to put this together. It's not just me and Bailey in our homes putting this together. It takes a whole team, but Bailey is an excellent producer. Bailey, I'm wondering, though, do you think you could beat Austin Wagner in a foot race? Lions are fast, right? Aren't they? Or maybe I'm thinking of cheetahs. I could have that wrong. On your ATV, sure. All right, sure. Well, we've done This Week in Kings News. We've done This Week in Kings Birthdays. It's time for This Week in Kings History.
22nd, 1976, Butch Goring scored in overtime of Game 6 against the Boston Bruins to force Game 7. Goring is still ranked 7th in all-time goals and points for the LA Kings with 275 goals and 659 points. And of course, he holds the franchise record for most times carried off the ice on his teammates' shoulders.
From the slot, ends the game. The Kings win it. 4-3. We'll get him back to Boston.
On April 23rd, 2001, Adam Deadmarsh completed the first round upset of the Detroit Red Wings, scoring in overtime of Game 6 to send the Kings on to the second round. The Red Wings had swept the Kings in the 2001 playoffs, and seeing Chris Osgood on his back while the Kings celebrated the victory remains one of my fondest Kings memories.
Adam Deadmarsh eliminates the Red Wings. The Kings, in overtime, have pulled the upset here in this first round.
On April 22, 2012, Trevor Lewis hounded Dan Hamhuis in the Canucks' defensive zone to create a turnover at the blue line, and Jarrett Stoll beat Corey Schneider to upset the President's Trophy-winning Vancouver Canucks in Game 5 in Vancouver. The Kings would, of course, go on to win the Stanley Cup that season, and it was the first time since the win against Detroit that the Kings had reached the second round. And finally, on April 24th, 2014, in Game 4 and on his birthday, Tyler Toffoli scored the game-winning goal against the Sharks to give the Kings their first win in the series and to prevent the sweep at the hands of San Jose. LA would go on to beat the Sharks in 7 games, completing just the 4th reverse sweep in NHL history, and it all started with that win in Game 4.
Had energy, enthusiasm all night long.
Look, I'd be lying if I said I didn't get goosebumps and tear up a little bit watching some of those highlight clips. We're going to have some more in the coming weeks, and they're just going to get more and more fun. But look, this is all the Kings, men, and we want you, the fans, to participate. So if you're an artist like my friend Jermaine, who did this portrait of Anže Kopitar, or if you are an artist like my friend Thalia, who did this portrait of Matt Luff and his dog Meatball. Meatball, right? I get Matt Luff and Meatball mixed up in my head all the time. Anyway, if you're a songwriter, if you have collectibles, if you have jersey collection, a fan cave you want to show us, or if you're like me and you have a Wayne Gretzky light switch cover plate, inexplicably, there we go. I don't know if you can see that or not. But if you have something that you want to share with us, go ahead, again, reach out to me or Bailey on social media. We will try and get you involved in this portion of the show. We're going to call it fan participation. We want to hear from you. We want to showcase just how passionate and how invested Kings fans are. In the meantime, because it is fan participation, we're going to go ahead and give away some more prizes from Manscaped. For those of you watching, go ahead and type the word Manscaped into the chat. We will go ahead and give out 5 prize packages from them. Thanks again to Manscaped for presenting the show.
It's one all, one shot, now the future is yours, go!
There he is. Sean, as a young boy, wanted to do everything great.
Jersey with a toe drag, trying to walk Vladdy, backhand shot, and he scores!
I'm a motivated kid. You know, I'm willing to do whatever it takes. It's right in the cusp of my hands, and you know, it's up to me to go and work for it.
Now, this is All the Kings Men, and what would All the Kings Men be without a conversation that goes straight off the rails? So to play the Robin to my off-the-rails conversation, Batman, Dave Joseph, how are you doing tonight, Dave? No, we can't hear you, Dave. You're going to have to unmute yourself there.
Let's try that again, Jesse.
Yeah,
I'm doing great.
Try.
Thanks for having me, buddy.
So, Dave, you are probably the biggest football fan I know. You're a huge Packers fan. Did you watch the NFL draft tonight?
I did watch the NFL draft, and as a matter of fact, the Packers just selected Jordan Love, quarterback out of Utah State, who's going to succeed Aaron Rodgers in a couple of years. He's going to learn under Rodgers the way Rodgers learned under Favre. This is huge news, Jesse. I'm pumped.
Are you?
I am, yeah. This is actually really good.
All right, good. I was able to watch a little bit of it. I couldn't watch the last 30 minutes, obviously, but I have to say I was pretty impressed with how they pulled it all together, given the restrictions with social distancing and everything. What did you think?
Yeah, that was good. You had Roger Goodell, the commissioner of the NFL, in his basement, as they were saying. At least that's what they called it. It looked like a basement. And then you had all the possible draft selections at their homes or wherever they might be, and they had cameras on all of them, and they would do interviews with them afterwards. So the only thing that was missing was the in-person feel to it, and the actual physical touching or the hugs or, you know, stuff like that coming up on a stage. I thought it was actually done very well. The only thing I missed, they had a computer behind computer screen behind Roger Goodell, and they had the fans of the team who was picking.
I saw that.
And they would boo the commissioner before he would give the pick, because that's what they always do. I thought that was a nice little touch. The boos could have been a little bit more, but kudos to them for figuring that out. That was good.
I want to know which sport started booing the commissioner first, because obviously booing Gary Bettman is a long-held tradition in the NHL, and it seems to me that goes back at least to like 94, 95, and he only took over as commissioner in 92 or 93, I think.
Yeah, they've been booing Commissioner Bettman for a long, long time. You're right. So I would say he was before Goodell. Before Goodell, I don't know that the commissioner got booed as much or as mightily, maybe. So
I think hockey fans might have started that tradition.
They may have. They may have. Now Gary Bettman can't go anywhere without getting booed.
Yeah, so. I'm proud of us, frankly.
Way to go, NHL fans.
It's one of my favorite traditions, honestly, and I think I love people getting upset about that more than anything else. But I want to talk about the fans on the screen behind the commissioner, because I saw there was one 49er fan in particular where there was he had his camera maybe 2 inches away from his face, and he was just doing this the whole time.
Yeah.
Who's got the energy to keep doing that? Like, nobody's interacting with you. You're just home alone, just going crazy, but good for them.
People get pumped for the NFL draft like I've never seen before. And keep in mind, it was supposed to be in Las Vegas this year, and with this whole thing going on with the coronavirus, it got shut down. They put the kibosh on it, but now the commissioner announced that the NFL draft will be in Vegas next year, so they will have the opportunity to host the draft.
And, of course, that would have been the Las Vegas Raiders' first opportunity to draft, and they mentioned that when they took their pick. But I thought the graphics were great, the sound was great, the video was great. It makes me wonder why the horse competition on ESPN turned out so poorly, frankly.
Yeah, and I wonder why the cornhole championships are do so well. You know what I mean?
Right.
It's enthralling to watch. But, yeah, and congratulations to the Cincinnati Bengals picking up Joe Burrow from LSU. Big quarterback. That's a franchise changer for the Cincinnati Bengals.
Yeah, and let's talk about that real quick, because there was a lot of talk in the week leading up, and apologies to anybody who's wondering why we're talking about football. We will get back to hockey in just a second. But I want to talk about the strategy of drafting, because I don't think we see this in hockey. In football, there's a lot of, well, this team is talking about this prospect to throw other teams off the scent, so maybe they'll trade up because they think their guy is available, blah, blah. I don't really see a lot of that in hockey. Do you like that aspect of the draft, Dave? Do you enjoy the drama of who's going to take who, you know, of trying to bluff other teams?
Yeah, I enjoy that. I think there's a science to that the people on the inside really know. Packers just traded up to get Jordan Love, so they traded up 3 spots because they probably didn't think he was going to be there at 30. I like that. I wish we would see more of that. I wish we would see more of the trading up and the trading of players to get, you know, higher draft picks and things like that. I think that just adds a lot more than a straight draft where you pick player after player after player after player. Everybody kind of knows how they're going to go. You see some differences in there, some guys, some surprises who might pop in. I like when there's, hey, we're going to trade you this player for these picks, or we're going to trade up to get, you know, 10 spots higher because we want this guy at whatever number. I like that. I think there's a science to that. I like the madness. I like the buzz behind that too.
Well, then you're going to hate the suggestion I'm about to make, Dave.
Terrific.
Part of the reason I wanted to make it with you on is because you're one of my favorite people to pitch my crazy ideas on, because you're one of the few people who won't just call me an idiot and dismiss me right out of hand.
This is true.
I've brought it up a few times this season, but I'm going to go ahead and bring it up again. And I think that this summer represents an opportunity for us to move away from the draft completely. I don't think we should use a draft in the NHL.
So no draft altogether?
No totally draft altogether. If you're 18 years old, you can sign a contract with whoever you want.
Tell me, I'm not going to call you an idiot just yet. Tell me what you had in mind and how you think this is all going to work and play out.
All right. Well, for starters, I want to get to why I want to do this. And the biggest part of it is realistically speaking, if you go back and take any draft year in history, you know, like even the 2003 draft, which was supposed to be one of the deepest drafts in years, once you get past the 20th pick or the 23rd pick, chances are it doesn't matter. The guys wind up on teams that didn't draft them. The bulk of their career is played. They change teams. They move around. Or they just never make it, right? The bulk of the guys. So we're really talking about 15 to 20 guys that may actually matter in any given draft year. So we don't really need the draft to distribute talent fairly. We just want to avoid, you know, Sidney Crosby coming in 2005 and signing with the Detroit Red Wings, right, to prolong their dynasty another 30 years. That's the fear, right? But, and this is why I think it's time to get rid of it, there's only 23 roster spots per team, and if you're going to keep the three-year entry-level contract limit, and if you're going to keep a salary cap, guys aren't going to just keep coming in and joining the loaded teams. It might happen in the first season or two, right? Like, let's say Lafreniere gets to pick whatever team he wants to go to, and let's say Vegas finally does manage to win a Stanley Cup. Okay, maybe he signs with Vegas. But then the next season, the best player is not going to Vegas because they are already cap-strapped to begin with, and now they've got Lafreniere, you know, in line for a huge contract in three seasons. He's not going to go to Toronto. He's not going to go to Tampa Bay because all these teams already are loaded with stars. So you're going to have players making decisions based on playing time, based on scouting departments, based on development programs. And the draft is like, yes, there are some teams that do great by picking guys in the fifth, sixth, seventh rounds. And you can say, okay, good scouting, good development, great program. But there's also guys that wind up being players that are never drafted, right? Like, was it Matt Roy or Sean Walker? I can't remember off the top of my head that wasn't drafted. Blake Lizotte was never drafted. Ajax Alfalo was never drafted. And look, they're having NHL careers. So the draft is just a random way to distribute 600 players amongst teams when really they could just be signing wherever they want to.
Okay, so I'm going to play along with you here.
All right.
I see where you're going, and I'll take the bait.
Well, thanks.
Who select? Which team selects first? The team who finishes last in the previous season?
No, nobody selects first. You take your agent. You take your, you know, Jeff Solomon gets on the phone, and whoever the Jeff Solomon of all the other 30 teams are get on the phone, and they call the agents and. You know, it's just a recruiting frenzy.
It's an open call. It's just an open call. You call whoever you want, and they get entry level deals to start. Everybody gets an entry level deal to start. Yep. So you can't feed someone you can't throw them a bone and say, hey, we'll give you $5 million in your first year to come here.
No. I mean, well, it would work the same way it ordinarily did. Like, let's say Lafreniere is drafted by the Kings, right? Let's say the Kings win the draft lottery. They can sign him to an entry-level contract, but they can work in bonuses. They can, you know, there's ways of making it slightly more worthwhile. And even if you wanted to eliminate the entry-level cap, if you wanted to just say, yeah, look, you want to pay Alexis Lafreniere $20 million in his rookie season, go sick. And if it works out, then good for you. And if it doesn't, well, you just shot yourself in the foot for the cost of $20 million.
Ooh, all right. And let me throw this one at you. What if... two players are coming out of the same program.
Yeah.
You've got an Alex Turcotte coming out of Wisconsin.
Mm-hmm.
And he's got a teammate that he's playing with who he loves. And he says, hey, I'm going to the Kings. So when you decide you're going to go pro, you got to come to the Kings too. What if there's two or three guys and they do it, you know, LeBron James, Dwayne Wade thing. Hey, we're going to Miami to win the title. And that's what it feels like to me.
That's even more exciting. Let's say last season, all of those guys drafted out of the U.S.
Exciting. That's not exciting.
Come on.
At all.
No. If all the guys taken from the U.S. men's national team, right? How many were there? Six, seven, a dozen, it felt like.
Yeah.
If all of them decided to sign with Buffalo, right? Like not Ottawa because that's a Canadian team. But if all of them decided to sign with the Rangers or with Buffalo or with St. Louis or whatever American team it was. How incredible would that be? Remember how much excitement there was around Team USA, or Team North America, sorry, in the World Cup?
Yeah.
All the young players on one team?
Yeah.
Well, imagine getting to watch that for a full two or three seasons.
Yeah.
You're telling me you wouldn't love it? You would watch every second of it. You'd be
I don't
so excited.
Know. I don't know. It has the Miami Heat feel to it, where it's and now the Golden State feel to it, where everybody is, hey, let's all go here and let's play here. And eventually we'll all end up here. And then, I don't know, it just doesn't feel like it's a team thing anymore. It's just a bunch of players who say, all right, let's talk and get together and go play for the same team.
But this is what I said at the outset. And I think this is what people always forget when they tell me I'm an idiot when I present
this. I haven't told you that yet, by the way.
There is a roster limit, right? Like, let's say Turcotte and Zegras and whoever else got drafted that year decide, okay, we're all going to go to Buffalo. All right, well, Eichel's already in Buffalo, so nobody's playing 1C. right? So now you're looking at the second line. Well, okay, next year's draft. Well, nobody who's going to, you know, who would wind up being a top round pick is going to go in Buffalo because Buffalo's already stacked in their top six, right? So guys will make decisions. They're not just going to keep going to the best team, the best player, because you can't, right? There's a salary cap. Guys will sign max deals. Guys will take up assets and roster spots. The talent will be distributed. And, you know, the idea that the draft somehow is a solution to parity or a solution to teams tanking. First of all, I think teams should tank. Teams that have tanked successfully, Chicago, LA, Tampa, Pittsburgh, all went on to be quite good for quite some time. So I'm sorry, but I'll take 2 years of being awful as opposed to what the Edmonton Oilers did. So I don't know. I just think, and losing the excitement of the draft would be a bummer, I grant you, but it would be replaced by 24 mini drafts as all those players slowly release their signing information over the course of the offseason, right? July 1st, Lafreniere signs with Tampa. Then July 2nd, you know, Byfield signs somewhere, Drysdale signs somewhere. You get these releases all through the thing. And the only real thing that I think people would miss is the trading of draft picks, which I hate anyway.
Yeah, I mean, I see where you're coming from. I just think, okay, let me see that. Let me play devil's advocate. What if you have a team like Florida or a team like Arizona, and they had a bad season?
Yeah.
And all of the big name guys who are coming out of college and coming out of juniors have already gone to Washington. They've already gone to Tampa Bay. They've already gone to Chicago. They've already gone to Detroit. They've already gone every. So you have these other, you have these two teams sitting there saying, we can't land anybody. We're not able to land these big names out of college or out of juniors.
Mm-hmm.
So they just have to sign whoever they end up with?
Yeah. A, too bad, so sad. And B.
Well, then that shoots your tanking thing.
If you tank on purpose,
then who's going to want to go play for you?
No, you're right. In this format, there would be no tanking, but that's one of the other benefits of this system is that it would incentivize every single team in the league to try and be as good as possible. Because like you said, if all the top 15 guys drafted in a given year have been taken, well, now teams are going to have to be creative. They're going to have to go find the Alex Iafallos. They're going to go have to find the Blake Lizotte. They're going to have to build teams around defense and goaltending and fundamentals. You're not going to be able to just get a guy like Connor McDavid and shrug and go, well, we got a great player, so everybody will come love us. Teams are going to actually have to be good. There won't be seasons where teams take the year off. Fans won't have to pay for tickets in a season where the team isn't trying to compete. And you won't have things like these sell-offs at the trading deadline where you go, all right, well, we really love all these guys, but we have to make a decision, you know, value versus draft picks. Bailey, you want to hold that question up so I can hear it, see it real quick? Deke Slayer of the Kings prospects, what three give the gonna-be-a-star vibe? Dave, we talked about this real quick, but we saw Cole Hultz earlier, and I got to say I'm getting pretty excited for Cole Hultz.
Yeah, you like Cole Hultz. I'm excited to see Alex Turcotte, and hopefully he makes the team or ends up in Ontario next year and gets some seasoning down in the AHL. And then, some of these other guys, Arthur Kaliev is another one that I can't wait to see him play because from everything I've heard and seen, he's a pure goal scorer. He loves to put the puck in the net. He loves to shoot. You need guys like that. And then some of the other kids who are in the system right now, you could take your pick from Cale Clegg to Kapari to, go down the list. All these guys, Durzi to Akil Thomas. There's so many guys. That's the thing with the Kings. They have so many guys to pick from. Those two guys jump out at me, Kaliev and Turcotte. And, I'll take your guy, Hultz. I think that's a good selection.
Sure. Bailey is predicting 46 goals for Kaliev. Dave, one last question before we let you go. Talking about prospects, is Gabe Vilardi a prospect anymore?
Yes. Gabe Vilardi is still a prospect.
All right. I mean, yeah, 7 points in 10 games, pretty good.
But right, but he hasn't played a full season in the NHL. He hasn't played a full season in the AHL. So you still have to consider him a prospect. And he's still basically a kid when you look at the numbers. He's what is he, 20, 21?
I think so, 20, yeah.
I mean, he's a young guy, so he's definitely a prospect. He's a guy who's had some injury troubles, but I think you've liked what you've seen from him. I know I've liked what I've seen from him, and I hope he stays healthy and has just a tremendous career because he sure is off to a good start.
Yeah, the reason I asked, The Athletic gave a poll to Kings fans, and I think the top three prospects that fans were most excited for were Vilardi, Turcotte, and maybe Madden, I think. And I had sort of forgotten that Velarde is still a prospect.
So. Right. I guess if it's someone who hasn't played professional hockey yet.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, sure. Yeah.
All right. Well, listen, Dave, thanks for coming in. Thanks for not calling me an idiot on All the Kingsmen Live.
That'll come another time.
And we're going to go ahead and take a look around social media this week in Kings social media.
On the ice, but a busy week on social media to talk about it. Carlin Bathe from Fox Sports West. How are you doing, Carlin?
I'm doing well. Jesse, how are you doing?
I'm doing great. What have our Kings been up to?
They've been up to a lot of stuff. A lot of weird stuff.
Yeah.
Some of it cool, but a lot of it weird. Mm-hmm. And let's start off with the weirdest of them all, and it's Cal Peterson's cereal habits. He did a Q&A for NHL's Twitter, and someone had asked him, I guess like the order or how he eats his cereal. And he responded with, he puts the milk in first, then the cereal, then grabs a straw to drink the milk, and then finishes up the cereal. And my head exploded. And Jesse, I know you got some thoughts on this.
Yeah. Well, so I have a first person testimony from Michael Amadio that this is not true, that he's seen Cal Peterson eat cereal like a normal human being and not a sociopath. But more importantly, I just don't believe that Cal Peterson has like a stash of straws in his house to go through this every morning. And I don't think he'd use the same straw twice, because I don't believe that people keep straws. Like, do you have straws lying around your house? I don't.
People not keep straws. I mean, like, that's a typical household item that, you know, some have a bend, some have like a straightness to them, but you just, people have straws. Are you weird? Okay. Now I'm starting to second
maybe
guess.
I am. All right. You got me with that. Like, all right.
Yeah.
What are the odds that you'd have a thing full of straws? But generally speaking, I don't think people have a lot of straws lying around. The only time I ever have a straw is when I hit fast food joints. Anyway, I know that other Kings had some reactions, though.
They did. And Matt Luff, who's just taking over the internet since all of this has been happening, he responded acting out the way that Cal eats cereal in a TikTok. And it was genius. He also had the milk ready and then the cereal ready and like perfect proportions and everything. And it really kind of nailed it home how weird that order of cereal eating is. Really just kind of solidified that picture.
I want to know how much pre-production time Matt Luff spends on his TikToks. That's all I want.
I'd love to know that.
Coming out of this.
And who's helping him? Is this just himself, or is somebody holding the camera? Like, is this like a one-man band? I don't know.
It's not Meatball, so it's got to be somebody.
Oh, goodness. Well, on Twitter, Anze Kopitar tweeted about NBC showing the 2014 and 2012 Stanley Cup championship playoff runs and posted this really beautiful collage. And it kind of gave me the warm fuzzies thinking about maybe him and his family watching those games at home. And I know that we've been watching a lot of throwback hockey on NBC. So it's nice to know that some of the players are doing that as well. And looked like he appreciated it, Jesse.
Yeah. And I can't remember exactly how old his kids are, but I have to believe that this is that NBC showing those old games is an opportunity for Anze to encourage his kids to watch some of his memorable career moments without saying like, hey, why don't I put in this DVD or Blu-ray or whatever?
Yeah.
I don't know. I guess I'm aging myself talking about physical media there. But anyway.
Oh, gosh. Oh, I can just picture him now at breakfast. Like, look, daddy laid down and blocked shots. Look at him. Like vintage Kopitar right there. Oh, my gosh. I love that playoff run. Both of them were pretty great. Magical. Matt Luff made the list again because he had another TikTok where of course he did. He did the I'm just a kid challenge where you take a photo of you as a child and try and emulate that now as an adult. And it's set to the song I'm Just a Kid by Simple Plan, which came out in 2002. And Matt Luff was probably, I don't know, 5 years old when that song came out. And he looks about 5 years old in this photo that he tried to emulate. And he did a pretty good job, Jesse. What do you think?
He did a great job. But of course, just one more opportunity for me to feel like an old man. I had already stopped listening to popular music by 2002. So I don't know what TikTok is and I don't know what a Simple Plan is. But good job, Matt Luff.
Cal Peterson also back on this list. This is just Cal and Matt. Did we even realize that? It's just alternating between the two of them, but he's back on for a really cute reason, and it's because he got a dog, and this dog is just a, I don't know what it is, it's a fluff thing, like I don't even know the breed, but he needs a name, and he called to Twitter to help him name this dog. I think it's nameless still. Jesse, do you know if this dog has a name yet?
I haven't heard. The suggestion that I saw somebody make, which I liked the most, was Hobbs, since Cal's actual name is Calvin. And you'd have Calvin and I thought that
That's
was
the idea.
I thought I like apologies that. To whoever it was that said it on Twitter, but I thought that should have been the winner. But I know that Sean Dursey had a suggestion.
Oh yeah, he did. He said Durs.
Yeah. Which is
like
it's fine.
I mean
I think you hit the nail on the head. That breed is fluff. That's what
it's
kind
fluff.
Of it's a pretty
it's just
cute dog.
And it's commitment. Like if you name that dog Durs, that's like 13 years of Durs. So.
Yeah, no, you gotta do that. But I think Hobbs is the already the odds on favorite to win Bark Madness 2021 because
I hope so.
That dog is awfully cute.
Notice how he came out like what a day after Bark Madness.
Exactly. Yeah.
Close up shop.
Yeah.
We should have added that for our final take. Meatball Luff winning Bark Madness yet again.
That's right. That's, yeah, back to back first time back there. To or Bark to Bark, bark champion. To bark.
Congrats. Anyway,
thanks for joining us, Carlin.
Thanks for having me.
We'll come back and do this again next week.
You got it.
Huge thanks to Carlin Bade for joining me for that segment. Huge thanks to Dave Joseph for talking to me about the draft, Cole Hultz, Michael Amadio, Austin Wagner, and of course, producer Bailey. Yes, Bailey, but thank you too. And all the people hard at work at the Kings bringing this show to you. And most importantly of all, of course, thanks to the fans for watching us. Thanks for joining us. Please do reach out to Bailey again if you want your birthday, your anniversary, you know, the remembrance of the first time you went to a Kings game. If you've got fan caves, jersey collections, obscure pieces of Kings memorabilia, if you're an artist, if you want to take up being an artist, if you want to give your first shot at painting a painting, writing a song, whatever it is about the Kings, do reach out to us. We will try and include you in the future. As Bailey said, stay home, stay safe. And of course, thanks to Manscaped once again for presenting this episode of All the Kings Men Live.